while I'm tracking Utsanati. I'm getting a very, very faint signal in that direction. Somewhere down off the edge of the mountain. And I'm all bundled up because it's a blackberry winter, as they call it. It is the middle of May, and it's about 50 degrees right now. Well, 46, 48 degrees, somewhere in that area. Foggy, been raining off and on the past couple of days, and supposed to get back up in the 80s here very soon. So I have a feeling that Utsanati is hunkered down, down under some cover, and taking shelter, which is what I'm doing here with my hoodie. All right, let's find him. Straight ahead. Oh, wait a minute. Seems like he's more in the direction of the Cherokee village. Looks like we're gonna have to go into the forest. That is such a big, impressive poplar, isn't it? Look at that tree. What an ancient tree. Wow. Just to show you how big this tree is, take a look. Compare me to the tree. That's a big tree, isn't it? It could be 200 years old. I've never done a core on it, so I don't know, but I'm estimating probably 150 to 200. Wow, massive tree. All right, let's go find that snake. Once I found Utsanati about 30 feet directly in front of where I'm standing now, up near this log, and it was about this time of the year, so this really fits with his seasonal movements. He is not far. Ah, there he is. Found him. Right there. And sitting right on the surface. Wow, look at that. He is magnificent. And only 75 feet from the trail. The bottom of this blueberry patch. Beautiful snake. All right. So look where he's sitting. Sitting in a blueberry patch. Obviously the blueberries aren't ripe yet, but they're fully leafed out. And this patch is, it's not open to the sky, but there's a lot more solar radiation coming through here than there would be in the thicket of the thicket down here below me. So I see that that's probably why he's out here waiting for the cool air, the cool weather to move on and the warmth to come back here in the next couple of days. And he'll be in a great position to thermoregulate and of course to feed, because this is a great place to find rodents. There's an old rotting log over here. Provides a lot of shelter for rodents. And of course this blueberry patch where the rodents, you know, they know there's gonna be fruit here. You can see young fruit forming. Take a look. Okay, well, I call it a blueberry patch. Most people call these buckberries or huckleberries. They're a relative of the blueberry. And they're very tasty, but they're quite seedy. But they do provide a lot of nutritious food for rodents, for sure. Which then in turn provides some nutritious food for our friend Utsanati the rattlesnake. All right, Utsanati, I'm going to collect some data and leave you alone. Okay, so here's one last look at Utsanati before we head out to find Zoe. So he's traveled about 3/10 of a mile in 2 weeks since I last located him. He is about 110 feet north of his day 29 location, which was just up there on the other side of the trail that I mentioned earlier. And gosh, what a beautiful animal. So this is definitely significant data showing again that he is using the same area, the same habitat that he's used before. And you know, if he follows the same pattern that he did a couple of years ago, I believe he's going to go up beyond the Cherokee village. Of course, those of you that know Earthshine know where the Cherokee village is, but those of you that don't, he'll be going up near the top of the mountain. There's a big rocky outcrop area where there's several big slabs of rock, and not quite sure what he does there, but maybe this year we'll find out some interesting data that gives us some insight into his reasons for coming over to this side of the mountain and making such a long trek. I don't know, maybe he's looking for the girls. That would be my first thought, because it's coming up on rattlesnake breeding season very soon. And so maybe that's his reason. But, you know, it's pretty interesting that I've been following Utsanati and Zoe for, let's see, almost 3 years, and haven't seen any other rattlesnakes on the mountain. I know there's more here because I've had reports of them, but still, that's not a good sign for the population of rattlesnakes here at Earthshine. Let's head out. See you later, Utsanati. All right, it looks like Zoe is underground, or at least I can't see her, so I can't tell if she's underground or just hidden back in the debris of this fallen tree. She could be buried up deep underground in a hole, or just sitting on the surface under some leaf litter. But it's almost dark, and I'm not going to go digging around back in there. But at least we've narrowed down her location, which is only about 150 feet from where she was near that old tree over there. It's hard to see, but there's a dead tree kind of downhill and straight ahead about a week and a half ago. So she's not moved very far, but she is moving up this little drainage. There's a small spring. And look at this, you can see here. See the hole there? There's a little sinkhole. Because about 50 feet down the way here, there is a spring that bubbles up out of the ground. So underground here, we've got groundwater. And this little draw, this little drainage goes up the mountain up to near where my car's parked and drains this whole mountainside down into Flat Creek, way down below. So obviously it's a good place to hydrate yourself if you're an animal, but also it appears to be a really good place to take shelter where this big tree has fallen and roots have ripped up and exposed the ground and given access to all kinds of tunnels and cavities underground for animals like a rattlesnake to use for shelter and for hunting. All right, so that's it for Zoe today. I need to collect some data and then I'll give you a little bit more information. Okay, so Zoe's about 90 feet to the southwest of her day 73 location. She's down here underneath this fallen oak somewhere in the root clump, the root ball. I haven't found her. She's underground, or at least undercover somewhere. Maybe under a big piece of bark. Hard to tell, but I'm not going to go digging around in there because that would be a good way for me to get envenomated. So I'm just going to let her go about her business. I've collected my data, and I'm going to head home and call it a day. So that's it for Zoe and Utsanati's tracks for today, and we will be back to track the turtles in a few days. Oh, it's tough going in these woods, I tell you. But they sure are beautiful. Habitat is so important for wildlife. Places like this need to be preserved. I know we need places for people to live, but we also need places for wildlife to live. It's imperative that habitat be preserved because, as you have seen, if you've been following in the tracks of my snakes and turtles that I've been tracking all these years, you know that they go to places that are special to them for whatever reason. And they go to these places at the same times every year. You know, their hibernaculums, the places they spend the winter, places they feed, places they go to drink, to mate, and the places they go to lay their eggs in the turtle's case and to gestate their young, as in the rattlesnakes. Well, if those places are destroyed for roads or houses or whatever, gardens, farms, all these things are needed for us human animals. But if they're destroyed for these wild animals, well, something very important is lost. And they, of course, will die if they cannot adapt. And reptiles are not very good at adapting. At least these species of reptiles aren't. They suffer greatly when their habitat is disrupted in many ways. Now, in some ways, if their habitat's disrupted, as in, for instance, in a box turtle and even in the rattlesnake, if a small clearing is made that creates some edge habitat, then that creates a really nice opportunity for thermoregulation, as you've seen with the rattlesnake and the turtles. They like the edge habitat a lot. And that lets them get out in the sun, thermoregulate if they need to, or then move back into the shade when they get warm. Also, it provides a habitat for all kinds of wildlife. Many of those kinds of wildlife, those different species, are food sources for the box turtle or the rattlesnake. So if you do it right, if we manage the land correctly, for us and for wildlife, then things work. We benefit and wildlife benefits. But if we manage it incorrectly, such as clear cuts, urban sprawl, where there's no habitat for anything other than humans, well, the wildlife suffers. And if the wildlife suffers, we suffer. It's that simple. So think about that when you start working on your land, when you have a large piece of land and you want to manage it, even a small piece of land. Do your research. Learn what lives there first before you start taking down trees and busting up the ground. Do your research. Then you can live in harmony with wildlife instead of against it. Think about it.